Good morning, everyone. I will present how we can introduce superabnormalitic behavior in iron, manganese, and cobalt oxide spinel ring structures through nickel ion incorporations. Before, to know why we need to introduce nickel ions in these spinel structures, we first should know that all these first pro transition metal oxides with spinel structure have several very important applications. First, due to their multivalent metal ion contents, these metal oxide nanostructures are highly attractive materials for heterogeneous catalysis. They have been utilized not only catalysis but also for energy storage materials such as supercapacitors. While most of these metal oxides have antiferromagnetic behavior, if we introduce nickel ions, or other transition metal ions, they can transform ferromagnetic or superferromagnetic even at room temperatures. So, if these spinel nanostructures have good superferromagnetic behavior, they can be used as magnetic hyperthermia for magnetic hyperthermia. Drug delivery applications, they can be used as the magnetic resonance imaging contrast agents, and moreover they can be used as heterogeneous catalysis, especially which can be separated by magnetic field. So in case of monometallic metal oxides such as cobalt, manganese or iron oxides, they can be either antiferromagnetic spin, antiferromagnetic or ferromagnetic. These are their spin ordering, but if we incorporate nickel to prepare nickel cobaltite, nickel manganite or nickel ferrites, there is a good possibility that they can transform into superferromagnetic. So we prepare those materials by chemical synthesis and characterize them their magnetic properties to know if we can prepare or convert them to superferromagnetic at room temperature. So I stated our motivation of this work is to incorporate nickel ions in these oxides and nanostructures and measure their magnetic property or study their magnetic behavior so that if we can get their high saturation magnetization and superferromagnetic behaviors. Here are the procedures we used or adapted to prepare these nanostructures. In case of nickel cobalt oxides and nickel manganese oxide, we used solvothermal methods using ethylene glycol as solvent and acetate precursors of the metals and PVP as size controlling agent. So this a mixture we transformed to a round bottom flask and heated at 170 degrees centigrade for 4 hours. After this reaction, we collected the material by centrifugation, washing and drying at 150 degrees centigrade. The same procedures are adapted in case of nickel manganese oxide. However, after drying, we calcinate them or air annealed them at 300 degrees centigrade for 4 hours. On the other hand, nickel ferrite nanostructures were synthesized by solution combustion method, where we use the nitrate precursors, metal precursors were nitrates, and glycine as reducing agent. While heating them, this glycine react with these metal precursors, nitrate precursors, and form complexes, glycine metal complexes, which during a combustion process which breaks down or breaks to produce the ferrite particles. So, first we see that how is the X-ray diffraction patterns of these materials. In case of nickel cobaltite, where nickel cobalt ratio is 1:4, very low nickel content, we got the peaks corresponds to the nickel cobalt oxide phase in phase. Pure phase, but the peaks are very wide or broader which indicates that particle size is small. However, when this nickel cobalt ratio is increased to, for example, nickel cobalt 1:2, we, apart from these spinel peaks, we got some extra peaks in these positions. Here's about 64, about 44 degree, and these peaks corresponds to nickel cobalt 1-X oxygen, so which is also a nickel cobalt oxide, but which has no spinel phase. It is sodium chloride striped structures. Okay, so quite different. In the case of nickel manganite, same thing happens. For low nickel content, for example, nickel manganese 1:4, we got all spinel peaks corresponds to nickel manganite. Okay, when we nickel manganese increased, nickel manganese ratio increased, same peak we got, but a little bit of broadened peak. However, when nickel manganese ratio is 1:1, apart from the spinel peaks, we got several other peaks. For example, here about 54 or 53, about 45, and about 37 degree, we got three peaks. These peaks are either nickel or nickel oxides. Some are nickel and nickel oxides. Obviously, these things. In the case of nickel ferrite, we prepare only one sample with nickel is to iron ratio 1:2, and we got perfectly the spinel structures with a very sharp X-ray diffraction patterns, sharp peaks, which were indicate that particles are highly crystalline. Okay, so in the case of in morphology, the here in the same images you can see formation of spherical particle in the case of nickel cobaltite, okay, of about less than 50 nanometer sizes, more or less good dispersions. But in the case of nickel manganite, the particles are agglomerated. They are very small, but they are agglomerated. We should remember that these samples are annealed at 300 degrees centigrade in air. That might be the reason the particles are agglomerated. In the case of nickel ferrite, which was prepared by solution combustion process, particles are more or less dispersed, but the formation of fluffy materials, as you can see, this part, these are fluffy materials, are visible. It's very common in the case of solution combustion synthesis. In the EDS patterns represent here in the right side, as you can see, all the samples reveal their corresponding signals, absolutely all perfect, nothing extra. Only small carbon peak corresponds to some carbon contaminations maybe. But what you can see that the nickel peak, nickel emission peaks and cobalt emission peaks, they overlap in the case of nickel cobaltite. In case of nickel manganite, same thing, oxygen and manganese peaks, okay, emission peaks are overlapping. In the case of nickel ferrite, such things doesn't appear. So all the peaks correspond, elemental peaks are well separated. When we estimated their composition for EDS, okay, as you can see, in the case of nickel cobaltite 1:4 nickel cobalt ratio, we got estimate is 1:3.37. Okay, in case of nickel manganese 1:1, we got 1:0.72. So this type. On the other hand, nickel iron and nickel ferrite, nickel iron ratio 1:2, we got 1:1.94. This is pretty close, but however, in the earlier two cases, the ratio is not so close to their nominal. That may be the one reason can be there due to their overlapping of these positions or peaks of nickel and cobalt here, and nickel and manganese and oxygen in the second case, the estimation was not perfect. Okay, the composition estimation was not perfect, so atomic ratio was quite deviated from their nominal value. Okay, to understand their magnetic properties, okay, of these spinel structures, we must understand or know that which metal ions in the spinel lattice occupy which sites, means tetrahedral site or octahedral site. Okay, as you know, the changes in the energies of the electrons occupying 3d orbitals of a metal ions depends where they occupy, which site they occupy in the spinel, that is, okay, when they occupies octadial sites or tetradial site, their angle changes. Here we present schematically their position of the energy positions of the electrons. In case of, especially in case of manganese 3 plus ion, that it has 4 electrons in the 3d orbital. If we consider imaginary a spherical symmetric or electrostatic field, they all of them electrons will occupy in the same energy levels. If these electrons are positions in octahedral symmetry or octahedral crystal field, spin orbit splitting occurs. Some of the electrons will be in spin up state in upper level, and some will be the lower level. The lower level is a triply degenerate, and the upper level is doubly degenerate states. Okay. In the case of tetrahedral symmetry or crystal symmetry, the spin orbit also splitting also occurs, but spin orbit splitting value is quite less. Okay, and I mean from barycenter they are not so far as like octahedral sites. So why this splitting occurs and why their energy level, okay, in different levels, why the energy level of these electrons are different, that we can understand if we consider the angular functions of atomic degree orbitals. In the case of 3z square electrons, as you can see here, the orbital electrons and the ligand electrons, which is the oxygen ions, are in the same line, okay, they are aligned in the same line, so that those two electrons are very close, and so they suffer or they feel a strong electrostatic repulsions. The same thing happens in case of 3dz square minus y square electrons. However, so they remain at the higher energy states. On the other hand, in case of 3dxy electrons or xz electron or yz electrons, the electrons in the orbital and the electrons in the ligand, they are not so close, so they feel lower or small amount of electrostatic repulsive force, so their energy level remains below the barycenter. So in this way that we know which electron will stay at the upper level, upper energy levels, and which electron is to the lower orbital levels. Okay, so to know how these electrons, okay, or which atoms, which ions of this spinel lattice will occupy which site, we must consider their octahedral site preponderance energy of the cations. Okay, so how to know that their octahedral site preponderance energy? We must check first their the crystal stabilization energy of these ions at octahedral site and tetrahedral sites. So on calculating their octahedral site crystal field stabilization energy of each of the ions, considering their 3D relations, how many 3D relations they have, we can see these are the energy value we obtain for octahedral sites stabilization energy and for tetrahedral site stabilization energy. The difference between the octahedral site stabilization energy and tetrahedral site stabilization energy will give the octahedral site preference energies. Okay, as you can see in this table, this cobalt 3 plus, nickel 2 plus, manganese 3 plus and manganese 4 plus cations have large octahedral site preference energies. See, you can see they are large, minus 79.5, okay, kilojoule per mole, minus 86, minus 95, and here also about 301 difference, because it is all will be in octahedral sites. So when we incorporate nickel ions in these crystal lattice, there are always a restriction that after certain amount of nickel ions will not be occupied, or they will not be allowed to occupy neither octahedral or tetrahedral sites, so they can form some impurity, as we have seen earlier. That will be clear here. And see, here we present both the electron distributions or 3D electron distribution of for cations, all the cations, okay, in nickel cobaltite, nickel manganite, and nickel ferrite. As you can see, cobalt 2 plus ion is at the lowest octahedral preference energy, has lowest. So lowest octahedral preference energy means it will remain in the tetrahedral sites. So as you can see, cobalt 2 plus here, it remains in the tetrahedral sites in the lattice. Okay. On the other hand, nickel 2 plus, as it has highest octahedral preference energy, it will stay in the octahedral sites. Yeah. All this thing up, you can see. On the other hand, cobalt 3 plus as an intermediate octahedral preference, it can stay both at octahedral site and tetrahedral sites. Okay. Similarly, we can say for manganese, nickel manganite and nickel ferrite. Okay. So nickel ferrites. So considering all those things, and we measure the magnetic properties, magnetization versus magnetic free curve at room temperature for these especially three materials. There are three compounds: nickel cobaltite with nickel cobalt ratio 1:4, nickel manganite, nickel manganese ratio 1:1, and nickel ferrite as nickel iron ratio 1:2. So as you can see, we measured for all the samples, but here we present the results of all the three, because these three, as you can see, presented the superparamagnetic behavior and with high magnetic moment. That's very important. What our objective was. So what we did to explain those curves, their behavior, you can see. So about a particular composition, especially nickel cobalt ratio 1:4, is good superparamagnetic material. Beautiful. The other composition are not so supermagnetic, they are rather, you can tell, paramagnetic with slightly ferromagnetic behavior contribution. Here is partially almost paramagnetic, all other composition except 1:1, which is superparamagnetic. In the case of 1:2 nickel iron, it is superparamagnetic. So here we consider only those three materials, and they are to calculate their magnetic moment. To how to calculate their magnetic moment? So we, according to their electron preference energy or octahedral sites preference energy of each of them, as we discussed here, we calculated or we position their tetrahedral coordination and octahedral site electron cation distribution in this compound. Okay. So in case also, and calculated their magnetic moment at octahedral sites and magnetic moment of the cations at tetrahedral sites. As you can see, in case of octahedral site, we can see about only 30% of nickel plus, 30% of octahedral sites are occupied by nickel 2 plus ions. So here we call their Bohr magnetron of each ion, and 30% of the octahedral sites, and we have 16 octahedral sites. So we multiplying them, we are getting the contribution of nickel plus 2 ions is about 13.6 Bohr magnetron. On the other hand, cobalt 3 plus ion, though it occupy octahedral sites about 70% octahedral sites, but as their magnetic moment, okay, Bohr magnetic moment is 0, so we have total contribution 0. Similarly, for tetrahedral sites, we can say here 40% tetrahedral sites occupied by cobalt 2 plus ions, and 60% with cobalt 3 plus ions. If we consider same way and consider the existence of 8 tetrahedral sites in one unit cell of this lattice, then we get their total magnetization of the D sites. So the difference between octahedral site magnetization contribution and octahedral sites and tetrahedral sites, which is about 25 Bohr magnetron, that's their per unit cell magnetic moment for unit cells. Similar things we did in the case of nickel manganese compound, nickel manganite, for nickel manganese 1:1, and we got the calculated the contribution of magnetic moment, contribution in magnetic moment of the all the ions, and the difference in this case of total net magnetic moment of the lattice here is about 25 Bohr magnetron. Same thing we did for nickel ferrite, and here very simple difference is about 22.6 Bohr magnetron. Here in this table we enlist the estimated net magnetic moment per unit cell. This is in the case of nickel cobaltite, where nickel cobalt ratio is 1:4, which gave our super paramagnetic behavior. Okay, so if we divide the formula unit, every unit cell has about eight formula units. So if we divide it, it will come theoretically per formula unit, it will be about 3.13 Bohr magnetron. But experimentally, we got 2.82 Bohr magnetron. So this difference is a little bit low than that is expected. Difference may be the small size of nanoparticles. As you know, in small size means higher specific surface area. So in the surface, spins are highly disordered. In the case of nickel manganite, okay, per unit cell, we should get 11.17 Bohr magnetron. Per unit formula unit, we should get 1.4 Bohr magnetron. But experimentally, what we determine is 0.55 Bohr magnetron. It is quite low, about less than 50% as the expected value. This you should must remember that in this material we have impurities like nickel oxide, and nickel oxide is also antiferromagnetic. Okay, so it does not contribute to the supermagnetic contribution. So apart from that, particles are also small. In the case of nickel ferrite, per formula unit, if the magnetic moment, net magnetic moment should be about 22.6 Bohr magnetron, and per unit cell, sorry, and per formula unit it should be 2.83 Bohr magnetron, but we got 1.30 Bohr magnetron. We should remember that this material we prepared by solution combustion process, and it is a proof in nature. And proof in nature means it has high surface area and highly disordered in the surface. Yes, spin disorder also. So in conclusion, we can tell that through using this solution as well as solvothermal and solution combustion process technique, we can prepare nickel cobaltite, nickel manganite, and with different mole fractions of nickel and nickel ferrite particles from 15 to 100 nanometer size range. The nickel cobaltite, especially the nickel cobalt ratio, 1:4 mole ratio, is with super paramagnetic behavior, very good saturation magnetization, means high saturation magnetization. And this nanoparticle is with much higher saturation magnetization than nickel ferrite and nickel manganite. This nickel cobaltite, nickel cobalt ratio, molar ratio 1:4, are very promising materials for application in which high magnetization is necessary at room temperature, especially such as magnetic hyperthermia. And nickel manganite with 1:1 molar ratio, which gives super paramagnetic nature also, but it has lower saturation magnetization. Anyway, all these specific ferrites, all these metal oxides with certain nickel content, as we have shown, they are super paramagnetic. Okay, so they are very important material and useful material for especially catalysis, especially magnetic separate catalysis. Moreover, they can be used as MRI contrast agents, and they can be even used as magnetically guided drug delivery agents also. Okay, so however, in the case of nickel manganite, due to restriction of charge neutrality in the manganese and nickel manganite lattice, nickel content will be at a certain limit in where we present, but we estimated about 1:1.5 nickel manganese ratio. All those excess nickel can form nickel, either nickel metal or nickel oxide. So this is all, and some of the details what I could not tell or I didn't tell, you can find in the following articles. Okay, thank you very much.